Dabale, sir.
Yes, Dabale, sir is there.
Yes, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
The voice better now than the previous session or the same? Yes, so let's continue with our discussion. And I also want to ask, like, towards the end of session, I would like to show some work of my students. So in that case, can we allow the students to log into this? Some papers we have recently.
Tell me email IDs, I'll add them. I'll invite them.
I'm waiting for the reply, and I will send you the email ID of them. If they are around, then.
Yeah. Okay, sir.
Hello? Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. You're audible.
Yes, sir.
Hello? I will send the mail ID. I get it. Send it on your mobile number, or how do I send the mail? If you can message me.
Sir, you can send it to me or.
Or should I send it in this number? Or I can send it in this chat message, or
you can post it in chat box. I'll enable it. Yeah, it is enabled now.
Okay. Yeah. So let us begin from where we left. We are talking about deep learning architectures. And we said that there are two popular deep learning models, convolutional neural networks and recurrent neural networks. So let us discuss both of those models first. And then we'll show some practical applications where we can apply this model. So is the screen visible? And let me ask again, am I audible and visible?
Yes, sir. You're audible and screen is also visible.
So let's begin with the first architecture, that is convolutional neural network. Is also known as CNN. you said, it is made up of more than one convolutional layer. We'll see what happens in this convolutional layer. So we have, let's say we have an image of size n cross n. Let's ground it to some real problem. Let's say we have an image of a 6 cross 6 image. We have 6 cross 6 image on which we want to do some task of image segmentation or image recognition or any problem. So one way is, if you do it in traditional way, then input size is 36. You need to create a 36 bit array. You linearize this 6 cross 6 matrix and pass this element in the array and train the network. That is traditional way of doing it. Or another thing you can do is, you can do some image processing, apply some image processing technique and extract some features. So approach one would be, bit input. So 1, 2, 3 up to 36. And then 8 or 2 if you want to even there. And then some output. And then a fully connected network of this, which you train, and expect the particular output that you want. So that is approach one. So you are not doing any kind of feature engineering, but expecting this hidden layer to identify the important features, and you expect that it will perform the task. So there is complete blind architecture where you just supply the image and expect hidden layer to do all the things for you. That is one thing. There are two issues. One is input size. As the image size grows, you play with so many weight parameters, and the training becomes more and more complex. Plus, you do not know actually what role every hidden layer is playing. So you are saying that the hidden layer will be used for nonlinear mapping, as we discussed earlier. But you are not actually separating. You are not saying, you are not identifying role of this neuron or role of this neuron. So you are expecting that the network will automatically learn the weight, and the neurons, which I have put question mark on, will map certain functions. But you don't know what function it will map. So there is one approach. Second approach is biased approach, where you can select that only this neuron is responsible for only this weight. So instead of fully connected approach, so let's call it approach 1.1. So just one approach, which I have modified. And we can say that this input 1 and 2 will go to only neuron 1, and third neuron will be input to only the second hidden layer neuron and all that. So instead of a fully connected network, you are deciding the connections upfront. You are adding your bias, and you are saying that this hidden layer is responsible for only this set of input, and another hidden layer is responsible for another set of input. So in a way, you are trying to separate the input space into certain parts as per your understanding of the problem. That is second approach. A third thing that you can do is, you, instead of supplying this 36 features as it is, you can do some feature engineering. And create a smaller network. You can see all 36 inputs are not always important, particularly for an image. Usually corners doesn't give any information, or centers has more information than the corners. You can do some kind of, apply some kind of heuristic. You can say that everything, the color, background color is not important. So whichever color component has maximum pixels, remove those and only use some entropy and only use the important colors and so on. Just a second, I need to take it off. I break for typing in two MAC addresses. That's why you could not hear me. Yeah, so I guess I'm back again. So I guess it is visible. So first approach was give a plain network and 36 input and some output. And second improvement on that was feature engineering. Do some feature engineering and make the network more compact so that you don't need to deal with any of the input parameters. So in that case, your network can be like first feature can be color features. Second set of features can be some wavelet transform or some transformation features. So that network will be more focused. You know exactly what you want them to, what you want the neural network to see and learn. So if you know that colors are important in this image, then you are training for colors. If you feel that the age detection is important for this image, then you can supply age, any age detection, apply any age detection and supply age information to the network and so on. So this is manually building features and reducing the size of the network. That is the approach two. So manual feature engineering and then training. And as we discussed earlier, this feature engineering plays a very important role in the network. But I just revised this two approaches to emphasis on one thing. So one is manually, if you are doing manual feature engineering, it will save a lot of time for training and it will be better than the supplying to blindly to the neural network. But the second thing is while we are giving this all input to a big network of one hidden layer or two hidden layers, then actually, though we are not doing feature engineering, we are expecting networks to learn these features. So this network somehow gets trained to this kind of features which we have just discussed, like age feature or color feature or wavelet features and all that. So network gets these features, and once the network gets the features, it will once the network gets features, it will start classifying. So in a way, we are hoping that network will learn. So this is what we are doing traditionally. So CNN is doing this thing more explicitly or more properly than the traditional network. So we say that we have a 6x6 image. Let's again start from here. We say that we have 6x6 image, and we want certain features from that image. So let me ground this to a problem of alphabet recognition. Let's say we want to recognize alphabet H. So we know that there are two features, right? Feature one is second is vertical line. So instead of blindly passing it to the neural network, or instead of running any image processing algorithm to extract features in advance, what we do here is we define a new layer called convolution layer. Which has filter plus pooling. Let us see what these filters are. So let's define two filters. Let's say filter one is something like this. -1, -1, -1, -1, -1, -1. I'm just giving you the values so far. We'll realize what is going on here. Let's say I have defined one filter like this, and let us say this X is represented like this. If you want to convert it into a number representation, it should be something like this. So all the places where there is a line, it will be one, other pixels will remain zero. Where I see X and is 1. And everything else will be zero. Now what I do is I do dot product of these two. So this is input. Let me name this as input, and this is filter one. So input dot filter. Just follow the math for some time and we'll know what is going on. So now when we are doing the dot product, we know that the size of the matrix are different. So what we do is we slide this convolution filter on this input from the beginning. add filter window on the input and calculate dot product. So first the filter window will start from the initial position. So first I will place the filter window here. This is the original position because it is 3 cross 3. So in iteration 1 or in first part, the filter window is x here. Do you see the screen? Are you with me or? Can someone answer or can someone message so that I know that? Okay. Okay, the difference is there.
Yes, sir, it is visible.
Is take this dot product of this screen which I have marked yellow square and filter, multiply them and take a dot product. So what you get is minus 1 into 0, 0, then 1 into 1, 1. So I guess this remains 1 and everything else becomes 0. Right, so this is first window which I got out of this. And since it is dot product, you will sum this up. So it will be equivalent to value 3. Similarly, you will do it for next. So now you will slide this window one step further. And the next square is, let me change the color. Next square is this. In iteration 2, or in second pass, you will be doing this 3. So now first 3 are 3 and rest of them are 0. So again, the sum will be, in this case, so first position of window. Let me say window position. 0, 0. Now I'm saying window position is 1, 0. No, sorry. So 0, 1. I am moving x axis. Say 1, or you want to say 0, 1. Now it is window position is 0, 1. So that is window is starting from here. So in that case, the result will be. One, and rest of the things are 0. So again, the dot product is 3. And then third pass. So in third, if I move further, again the dot. If you notice, again the dot product will be 3. And at position 0, 2 also it will be 3. And at position of 0, 3 also it will be. I will put it as first row of the matrix. Let's call it 3, 3, 3, and 3. And I have finished passing through first row of. I have passed the sliding window through first row. Now what I do is I will slide one column down, and I will start from 0, 1, 1, 1, and so on. And what will be my answers in that case? Can someone calculate and help me just to verify that you are all following? If the window is starting from here, the question is, if the window is starting from here, what will be the dot product? Can someone answer this? So it seems like it's getting difficult. So if window is starting from here, the window area is this. And imagine placing this filter on this window area and take dot product of values. So I think all places where you see 1 will become 1 and rest of the things will remain 0. And then sum it up. So the summation will be 4, right? Answer will be 4.
2.
Or 4?
It will be 2, sir.
Okay, yes, 2. It is 1 plus 1 minus.
Minus 1.
similarly, what will be the second value? If you pass it to next level, it will be again 2 minus. If you pass to next window, it will be minus 3, minus 4, and 1. So is it minus 3? Oh, did I make mistake in the first row then? I guess yes, first row also needs to be corrected, right, in that case? Because we are expecting 1 in center. So this should be minus 3, second should be. Minus 3, this should be minus 3, then this should also be minus 3, and last one should be 3, right? Then 2, then minus 3, then you move one bit further, and you get only 1 plus and 4 minus, so again it is minus 3. And move to the last one, and last one 3 and 2. Okay. So are you all getting this value? I am doing it with you. So please correct me if I am making mistake. Then again, go to the next step. So we are starting now from here, third step. We are starting from this step. And now 3 plus 1 minus, so again it is 2. Sorry, we are starting from here. We are starting from, let me cover in the color, so I remember. We are starting from now this bit. We are starting from here. So 3 plus n, 1 minus, that will be 2. Then the next position, and in next position, we'll get again 3 plus n, 1 minus, so that is again 2. Then in the next position, again, if you see, there are 1 plus and 4 minus, so minus 3. And the last position is this one, this 3. So 3 plus and 1 minus, so again it is 2. And so on. Just verify whether my calculations are correct or not, and tell me the last calculation also. Are you getting the same answer? Can someone confirm? Yeah, any answers? Are you doing that calculation or are you getting the same answers? So let me finish the last row also, then last row will be 2, then again next row is minus 5, no, minus 4, sorry, is minus 3. Then next row is minus 3, and the next one 2. Are you all getting this answer? Can someone confirm? I just see you're not following. Anyway, so this is the convolution output. So once the convolution is done, what we are left with is So once the colonization is done, what we are left with is a new feature map. Of 6x6 image. This is a feature map of 6x6 image. So once we have this feature map, now we are training on this. So if you have noticed how the CM is different from the traditional network is, then you can have multiple such feature maps. So for a given input image, you can construct. For the given input image, first we pass it through the convolution filters, the one which we had just seen. So it will perform, it will serve two purposes. One is, it will reduce, it, if you have seen, it reduces the dimension. One benefit is reduce dimension. And second is, it represents a feature. Right, so the blind network which we discussed here, expecting network to learn the feature. Here we are supplying features in a way to model the features that we want. So just in case if you notice, so this was feature for vertical line. Can anyone tell me what can be a good feature for a horizontal line? This feature was for vertical line. It tells you that out of this window of 9 pixels, where you spot the vertical line, based on that it gives the answer. So if you read for horizontal line, the feature would be
so the second row should be 111.
Yes, second row should be 111, and all others are -1, -1.
Yes.
So if you multiply by this, you will get a new feature map of again 6x6 size and so on. So these are the filters. So this can be a input image, this can be a horizontal line, this can be vertical line, this can be corners, whichever features you want to define. And this can further be defined, be reduced by something called pooling. I wish to calculate that also, but I believe that you are not participating in pooling in calculation. So I will just give you the idea of pooling. So pooling is a way to further reduce the size of data. There are two popular techniques, max pooling or min pooling. So after a window, pick up the maximum number, and instead of 4 bit, represent only by 1 bit. That is called max pooling. So if I want to do pooling on this, what I would do is, I would further divide this into 4 subsections, and I will pick up the max number from each of these. So here the max is 3. So the max pooling will give me 3 here. In second also it will give 3. In third it will give 2. In fourth it will give 2. So this is final output after max pooling. of convolution layer in this example. If I want to do mean pooling, I will take mean of this end, I will do that. So it further reduces the size of implementation. And this works for image processing, because in image processing, not every, as we discussed, not every corner is important. So this basically creates the architecture of convolution neural network. The convolution neural network is a sequence of such convolution and layers which contains filters and pooling. So you can apply number of filters and pooling as many as you want. It can pass through number of layers also. Then it goes to next layer. Again, next layer can be a filter of pooling layer. And then finally, you can have a complete ML access, multi-layer feed forward network. And then the training can be through backpropagation. So if you have noticed, there are certain differences from the traditional network. One is now we can have any number of hidden layers. Second is now hidden layers are well defined. You know that this filter has a certain role. So filter and pooling are well defined. And you can iterate over this, or you can put any number of filters and pooling network before you go to multi-layer feed forward network. That is one part. The second part is, it is not similar to feature extraction. Now, some of you might ask that how is it different from the traditional network where we extract the feature and we train the network? Because anyway, we are here defining filters, right? So the difference here is the filters are tunable weights. The values that we have put in filters are actually the weight values. They are tunable. So through this training, the filters will also get updated. So this filter's value will also get updated, and finally, you will achieve the right feature that we want. So initialized features, so this horizontal line, vertical line was a simple example to get the concept grounded, but in real life the filters might be more complex. So in that case, you start with some initial filter and then keep on updating the weight in a way that the filters get trained. And it is observed in many cases that every filter performs a certain particular image processing task, like some might be used for RGB detection, some might be used for foreground background detection, and so on. So this is how it works. So this is convolution neural network. I will stop here for a couple of minutes. If you have any questions on this, then please ask me, or we'll move to next architecture, RNN, and then we'll go to.
Sir, there is one question from Vikram, sir. I'll read for you, sir.
I have also invited you.
Hello, sir, can you hear me?
Please.
If I get 92% correctly detected,
yes, I can hear you.
Sir, I read question for you. If I get 92% correctly detected class, okay, then what do you think that where is the error?
Okay, you are saying if take, but which problem we are talking about? And it could be problem also.
Vikram sir, you can unmute and please ask the question. This is the question from Vikram Reddy sir.
Actually my question is the same. If I detect any class, suppose a dog or cat, some class, if I identify, I'm able to get 92% of accuracy, then I need to verify that where the 8% error is going to occur. That is, is it the hidden error I need to improve? Is it the convolution filters I need to improve? What do you think, where can I improve?
Yeah, so this is parameter tuning, and this parameter tuning is problem specific. So you need to look at the problem and initially the way you have initialized your filters or hidden layers, and based on that you can judge it. So this varies from problem to problem. So there may not be a one answer, like if you change this, it might improve the accuracy, but it depends on the problem.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
I request to other participants also to unmute and please ask your questions, or you can post in chat box also or question answer box.
Okay, then we'll move to the next part.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
Yes. Okay. So next part is, as we say, the two popular architectures are CNN and RNN. So next we'll take up recurrent neural network. So as we say, it is suitable for something called sequence labeling problem. And the basic architecture is something like this. So as we say, this is actually circular. This V is circular, which passes from timestamp to timestamp. So again, there are three layers: input layer, middle layer, and output layer. But the problem is sequence labeling problem. So the output of first for the previous input affects the next input. Let's again take the example of part of speech tagging. The example is Ram is a good boy, and what output we want is Ram is a proper noun, is a verb, A is an article, good is an adjective, and boy is a noun. So this is classic problem of part of speech tagging. And as we discussed earlier, when we see the previous tag, we can judge the next tag. So if you see the previous tag was article and A, then the next can be an adjective or a noun. Similarly, if the current tag that you have seen is a noun, then the next tag can be a verb. So there is a dependency between this. What you produce a previous table has a dependency. So this can be modeled through recurrent network. So what we can do is, if we unfold this network,
Sir, we can't see your screen, sir. But sir, are you there? Please wait, I think sir has left the session. All participants are requested to stay in the meet only, but sir, students will come and represent their work. Thank you. Hello, Bhatt sir, are you there?
I think I got disconnected in between.
Yes, sir.
So, can someone help me? Where did I left to when we were discussing that? I began with RNN. So were you there when I talked?
Recurrent. Hello, sir. Recurrent neural network.
RNN.
So did you hear this example? Ram is a good boy and all that. Or?
No. The basic that is output and input and.
Okay. So after
yeah,
that I talked
right.
about. Let's say RNN
yeah.
is used for. So Ram is
so
a good boy.
Explaining this example, sir. Part of.
Yeah, example. Part of speech tagging example you are discussing.
Right. So in between, I think I got disconnected. So part of speech is assigning part of speech every word. So if Ram is a good boy, then output is noun. Ram is noun. Verb is a verb. A is article and so on. So the recurrent neural network would look like this. Ram is a good boy. So there are five unfolding of the same network. The same network with input hidden and output layer will unfold for five times. First input at timestamp 0 is Ram, input at timestamp 1 is, input at timestamp 2 is A, input at timestamp 3 is good, and input at timestamp 4 is boy, and so on. And every timestamp it will produce the output. So now whenever you produce an output, you update the weight as you do in back propagation. So learning algorithm of RNN is also based on back propagation, but it has slight difference. It is called back propagation through time algorithm. Because whichever timestamp you produce the output, you need to update the weight that you have observed in every timestamp. So at all timestamps, it will get propagated. So if you are updating output at fifth output, that is boy is noun, timestamp 4, then you will update the weight 4 times or 5 times. First is 4 timestamp 4 output, then 4 timestamp 3 output, then 4 timestamp 2 output, and so on. So weight updation keeps on increasing. Same set of weight, but they will increase, update 5 times. So when you keep on increasing the, when this unfolding is very large, you have large sentence of 10, 20 words, then you need to update weight 4, 5, 10, 20 times. And in that case, the problem is as we propagate the error, the gradient value becomes very small and the weight update turns out to be insignificant. That is called problem of vanishing gradient. So this is what I was talking. Any questions on this? Or am I again disconnected? Or?
No, sir. You are audible, sir. And there was a question from Shubhangi, ma'am, sir.
Yeah.
CNN algorithm can be used for video processing?
Actually, I have invited some students who will show you application of CNN and LSTM or RNN both for video processing. But general trend is that for image and video processing, for image processing is CNN. For sequence labeling or text processing, it is RNN. And video is mix of both. In video, sometimes if you just want to focus on one frame and do some processing on a frame, then it might be CNN. But if you are trying to capture a sequence of action, then RNN can be a better choice. But the general intuitive answer is, if you want a two-dimensional, three-dimensional image, and you want to process it, then CNN. If you want to process on the previous situation is important for the next situation, then the answer is RNN. But RNN has this problem, and that's why there are some improvements on RNN, not some, but there are many. So one popular improvement I will suggest you, and then I think we'll leave for the recent papers that we want to discuss. That is called LSTM. That is long short term. Memory network. So the problem that we have discussed here, that vanishing gradient problem, is because of this. In hidden layer that you are passing, the vector v is again not controllable. Whatever vector you have defined, the same vector keeps on repeating. So if you can somehow control it, like when to update and when not to update, then it can be tuned. and that is LSTM. I will live with the architecture. LSTM architecture is something like this. So this is the hidden layer part, which we had discussed earlier in plain vanilla RNN. The hidden layer is just a set of vectors V. There is nothing tunable or nothing controllable. Here it becomes a bit more complex, and it is something like this. It has concept of three gates. So these three gates are, let me name they are called forget gates.
Your voice is low, sir.
Okay. Maybe. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are audible, but voice is low.
Yeah. So I think again I'm facing the network problem. So I will just end with definition, and I will go with the paper. So one is forget gate. Second is input gate. And third is the output gate. So these three gates controls the four gates across. Timestamp. Yeah, so again, let me stop here. We'll come back to this for question answer, but I guess if the students have joined, then we'll talk about the papers. So let me check. Have they joined? Is the link sent? Or?
Yes, sir, I'm here.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir, I have joined.
Yeah, so Deepan, please start with your talk. So yes. Deepan has published in Indian Conference Icon 2020. His work was on CNN and RNN both. It was a very challenging problem of speech recognition. So yeah, let's Deepan, please finish the presentation, then we can go with question answers.
Yes, sir. So hello everyone. I am here to present our work on end-to-end speech recognition for Gujarati language specifically. So the problem definition we are aiming to solve is to create an effective way of automatic speech recognition for the Gujarati language. And to solve this problem, we have approached it in three steps by making three major contributions, in which once an output is generated by the model, we decode it using a novel approach of prefix decoding with two language models. Further, transcript generated as an output of this decoding phase is processed to resolve the small spelling mistakes using the BERT language model. And following this, we provide an exhaustive error analysis of the words that have been mispredicted to understand the system even better. So There is a rich history of ASR systems, which started with the introduction of electronic-based systems and were followed by phoneme-based systems, which involved the first use of speech segmenter in different portions of input utterances. Then came the use of pattern recognition technology for ASR, which was based on linear predictive coding. And CMU's Harpy system was the first ever system to use the finite state network to reduce the computations for pattern matching in ASR. Now, with further research in speech recognition, statistical approaches like HMM-based speech recognition were introduced, and they showed some promising results, due to which they were further combined with various other machine learning techniques like ANN, GMM, and SVM. And then in 2006, Graves introduced a novel method for training RNNs to label unsegmented sequences directly using CTC, and thereby eliminating the drawbacks of HMM-based approaches and creating an effective end-to-end ASR system using RNNs. Now, with the increase in computational resources, deep learning-based models provided great results. And one of them was the encoder-decoder network, which used the encoder RNN to map the input to a fixed length vector, and a decoder network to expand the fixed length vector into a sequence of output predictions. And subsequently, an attention mechanism was added to the decoder, which provided amazing results. But the major issue with this approach was that it required a pretty large amount of data to be trained, and hence didn't perform well for low resource languages like Gujarati. Now, but the recent research in TDNN-based approaches have shown some promising results. And also, there has been some work similar to ours, which is presented as a combination of CNN by LSTM model for English language and other work using a combination of GRUs, which are another form of RNNs, for the Gujarati language. But our approach differs from them, as we present prefix beam decoding combined with two language models and a post-processing technique known as spell corrector BERT. So now let's understand the system design. Now, to design a deep learning based ASR system, we used MEL frequency spectral coefficients, MFCCs, as the features to train the model. These are basically the pictorial form of the audio waveforms, for which, as the first layer of the model architecture, we used the CNN layer, which slightly improves the ASR performance by removing the spectral variance, and hence the extracted features from CNN are further passed to deep bi-LSTM RNNs. Now, there are three bi-LSTM layers that help in modeling temporal information, and then the features extracted from these bi-LSTM layers are passed to a deep neural network, which consists of three layers, and the number of units in the last dense layer is equal to the number of characters in the language. So for Gujarati, there would be 76 characters present over there. Now, while training, a common technique for mapping variable length audio input to variable length output is the CTC algorithm, which is differentiable, and hence we use the CTC function to train the network with standard backpropagation through time. So the output generated from this network is passed to the prefix decoding algorithm, incorporates a WLM and a CLM, and CLM is the character level language model. And further, it provides the decoded output to us. Now, this decoded output is passed on to the spell corrector BERT, which provides us the final output text. So to conduct this experiment, we use the Microsoft speech corpus, in which we partition the data into three parts, namely training data of 28.2 hours, validation data of 8.5 hours, and testing data of 5.4 hours. And the model was trained on a single Tesla T4 GPU consisting of 16 GB of GPU memory and a CPU having 4 cores and a 16 GB of RAM. So now let's understand this decoding algorithm. So for this decoding, we present a novel approach of using two language models based prefix decoding, which uses our custom built 4-gram word level language model and bi-gram character level language model. And we have used the Gujarati data scraped from Wikipedia containing 2.5 million words with a vocabulary size of 163,000 words for both character level language model and word level language model. And using this prefix decoding with two language models gave us a coherent estimation of character sequence, which made a decent correction due to the introduction of language constraints to the output. So now we will see the working of this algorithm. The output that we get from our model is a matrix having t time steps. And at each time step, it provides probabilities for each character. For example, for an audio utterance speech recognition, we get an output from our model that we are going to decode using this approach. One by one, we iterate over each time step in the output. So let's say we are at time step t, then we will select top k prefixes. In the example, as you can see, we are currently at the first prefix, that is SPEEC. And now after selecting the prefix, we iterate over all characters and find the probability for each character when appended with the selected prefix. In the example, we have SPEC as our selected prefix, and we iterate over all the characters to find the probability of each character when appended to this prefix. Now then, while iterating over the characters, if a space character has encountered, then both CLM and WLM influences our calculations of probabilities. Otherwise, only CLM influences our probability calculations. We also consider insertion bonus in order to avoid bias towards shorter prefixes. And similarly, this process is repeated for all top k prefixes. Now this process is repeated for each time step available in the output. And once we have iterated over all the time steps, we return the most probable prefix. So this is the whole working of decoding algorithm. Now further, for post-processing, we have used the pre-trained multilingual BERT for spelling correction, hand in hand with a statistical language model to score the sentence. So the working of this post-processing algorithm is that we take a sentence and we find the replacements of the current word by finding its corresponding 0, 1 or 2 edit substitutes from the Wikipedia corpus. Now we get a list of all the substitutes of the current word as an output of this step. Then we check whether the word whose replacements we have found is present in the list already or not. If it is not present, then we replace that word with mask, and the sentences are generated by replacing that word, that mask, with the word replacements from this replacements list. Now further, the sentences are tokenized and passed to the BERT model. And as an output, BERT returns a list of replaced words with their respective probabilities with respect to the sentence. Now from this list, we select the top k words replacements with the highest probability and append this list of word replacements to the output list. On the other hand, if the word is already present in the list of replacements, then we append it as it is, because it is grammatically correct. And this process is followed for each and every word in the sentence. And once all the words are iterated, a final output list is generated, which contains lists of all the words with at most k replacements for each word. Now the output list is passed to a combinator, which generates sentences by combining the words. If there is a list containing a single word in it, it is selected as it is. And if there is a list of word replacements, then various combinations are produced using the combinator. Now to select the best sentence out of all these sentences, a 4-gram WLM is used for sentence to the final output. As you can see in the diagram, the incorrect sentence Ahmedabad Airport is corrected to the correct sentence Ahmedabad Airport. So these approaches showed great results, as while using this prefix decoding algorithm with two language models, we achieved a 2.42% reduction in word error rate with respect to the greedy decoding. And further, passing its output to spell corrector BERT reduced the word error rate by 5.11% in total with respect to the greedy decoding, which shows the overall improvement in the accuracy of the ASR system. Now, despite of this improvement in the performance, there were some words that were not predicted correctly, and hence we performed an exhaustive error analysis to understand our system and open gates for new research on ways to solve these errors. Now, the basic reasons behind this are the errors due to noise, channel variability, speaker variability, etc. And the system analysis is performed on the model hypothesis, decoding using the prefix with LMs and the spell corrector BERT. So based on this analysis, the first observation was that the errors were due to consonants diacritics, and independents. An example of incorrect consonant prediction is the word kyare to kyare, where the consonant ta is replaced with consonant ka. And that of error due to diacritic is the word prarambhik to prarambhik. And the example of error due to independent is the word dharai to dharai. Now, from all the one letter erroneous words, 52.9% of words produced error because of incorrect consonant prediction. Due to incorrect independent prediction. So then we constructed a graph of interchanging consonants to understand which consonants are frequently interchanged, and one of the visible patterns was of the consonants that had similar sounds while pronunciation. So that were the consonants which were interchanged easily. Secondly, the error were due to the homophones. Out of all the single diacritic errors, only 2.97% of errors were due to the homophones. The main reason for this is the fact that Gujarati has 13 vowels, which is quite a large number, due to which the system wasn't much affected by the homophones. The third observation was that due to the changes in the speed of speech, there were errors due to half conjugate. Now, after total erroneous predicted words, 2.4% of them have half conjugate error, and out of those 2.4% words, 10% of words consist of pure half conjugate erroneous words. And finally, we observe the effect of word frequency, where there are a total of 1069 always correctly predicted words, out of which only 857 are present in our training dataset. So our system is able to learn from the utterances shown in the training and can infer unseen examples too. Now, the words which are predicted correctly as well as incorrectly have a correctness proportion of approximately 53.5%. So to conclude, we can say that even under low resource settings, we can improve the performance of ASR systems by using effective decoding and post-processing techniques. And moreover, system analysis can help us to understand ASR systems based on a particular language. In our case, it was Gujarati. As well as can govern ASR systems to improve the performance for low resource languages. So that's it from my side. Thank you.
So Dipan, please wait for question answer if there are any, and let's hear from Kinjal first. Kinjal, could you please start your presentation?
Yes, sir. So am I audible clearly?
Yes, ma'am, but your voice is low.
Okay, yeah. Now is it clear?
Your voice is low.
Okay.
It's clear, but voice is low.
Okay. So now
it's better.
Just a minute.
Ma'am, it's fine. You can continue.
Okay. So I hope the PPT is also visible.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So good afternoon, one and all. Myself, Kinjal Mistry, and I'm working as an assistant professor in computer engineering department at UKA Tarsadia University, Bardoli. And currently I'm pursuing PhD under guidance of Bridges sir. And I'm going to present a paper today on towards performance improvement in Indian Sign Language recognition. So this is the outline of the presentation. I'll start with the introduction to the sign language. So basically, the sign language is used by mute people or deaf and dumb people as a means of communication to express their thoughts and emotions with each other and with the person like us. So according to Durkin and Conte Ramsen, sign language can be considered as a collection of gestures, movements, postures, and facial expressions corresponding to letters and words in the spoken languages. So just like spoken language, sign language is also a natural language, but the main difference lies on the modality. And considering the sign language country-wise, each country has its own sign language with high degree of grammatical variations in it. So my work is on ISL, that is Indian Sign Language, and it is largely dominated by object features and is different than other international sign languages. So currently in India, around 430 human interpreters who are available for helping the deaf and dumb people in emergency situations. So so just to replace them, or replace that need, a system can be designed that offers flexible alternative when the human interpreters are not available. So for the same, the recognition of sign language is important. So that is known as SLR, that is sign language recognition. And that is an approach that converts the sign gestures into text or the speech. So basically the input is video or the image, and the output would be the text. So basically there are two approaches for any sign language recognition: device based and vision based approach. I'm not going in that much detail, but the device based on the sensors, and based on the sensors, they are recognizing the signs. Instead, the vision-based approaches are better, because the in the case of device-based approach, always the devices are must and they are needed, while vision-based approach works with the image or the videos. So this is related work. So I'll just skip this part. But basically, currently, if we talk about the Indian Sign Language recognition, then more of the approaches, or most of the approaches, work on image. Like the image is given as the input, and then corresponding text would be the output. And so our contribution is like we have addressed the issue of one particular research question, that how to use very small amount of input videos effectively in order to incorporate the signs without hurting the recognition performance of ISL words. So basically we are in the process of creating the data set, but this particular presentation, in this I'm going to represent a data set which is already available. And existing work, if we see, then there are very less amount of data which is available to work on, work with that. So we are going to incorporate both left-handed and right-handed signs, because a signer can be left-handed or right-handed. So the method that we have followed, or we have created, is basically this. So ISL video is the input. Then we have converted this video into frames. And then we have used the concept of horizontal flipping so that we can have the left-handed as well as the right-handed signs. And then we have used a novel frame sequence generator with the concept of data augmentation. And then this was given as input to the pre-trained model MobileNet V2 along with RML in order to get the word prediction. So I'll explain these steps one by one. So the first part was taking the ISL input video. It was converted into RGB frames, and videos were originally captured at 30 frames per second. So accordingly, the frames are generated. Each video was of different length. After this step, we have used horizontal flipping concept. So on the batch of the frames, we have performed horizontal flipping in order to incorporate both left-handed and right-handed signs. Then we have created a video generator that provides the decomposed frames for the entire video. We have done this in order to get more and more number of frame sequences, because the data set was very small. Like for each and every class, we had just 10 to 12 samples. So in order to make the data set bigger, we have created a frame sequence generator. For our experiment, we have selected 5 frames per second. So this was based on histogram difference, and based on that we have used this number as 5. One can also try with 6, 7s and can work with that. For each and every individual video, for example, the first batch of frames are 1, 7, 13, 19, 25 in sequence. The second batch will be having 2, 8, 14, 20, 26 in sequence, and so on. So on the resultant images, after this frame sequence generator, we have used the concept of data augmentation. So basically, this step, we have created this video generator in order to get more number of frame sequences from the data set. Apart from this, we have used image augmentation, as I say, in order to make the data set size inflated. So initially, and then we have used the concept of pre-trained model, and particularly we have used MobileNet V2, the version 2 of MobileNet, because it is small and it is a lightweight deep neural network, and it is best suited for embedded vision applications. So we have chosen this because later on our target is to have a system which can work on the mobile application as well. So for the same, we have used this. And then we have performed the fine tuning on this model by empirically changing the top layer configurations in order to get the best accuracy. So we have tried like freezing the bottom layers and just working with the top 5 layers, top 6 layers, top 9 layers, and so on. And based on this empirical experiments, we have chosen top 9 layers of the model for retraining with the augmented frame sequence. And then we have added one LFTM layer at the end. And before that, we have also injected one time distributed layer to have the one dimensional shape which is compatible with LFTM. We have used the data set which was published by Nandi et al. And this is the one and only data set which is publicly available for Indian Sign Language words. It is having total 21 classes, out of which 10 classes are for dynamic hand gestures. So we have considered those 10 classes for our experiments. This data set was created in July 2009 at IIIT Allahabad. So this table 1 shows the image sequences after using the frame sequence generator. So total classes which we have used are 10. Then the training samples were total in 79. The validation samples are 15. And testing samples are 27. Then on each and every training, validation, and testing samples, we have applied horizontal flipping. So this size would be doubled. So that's why the training samples, which were 79, later on they became 158. In the same way, validation samples, which were 15, later on we have the resultant as samples as 30. And in the same way, testing samples, which were 27, after horizontal flipping, we were getting 54. Then on all this training, validation, and testing samples, we have used our frame sequence generator, which was created by us. And these are total around 19,000 frame sequences, means 19,000 videos we have got after applying this frame sequence generator. So the first figure, figure 2, shows the sample frames from the data set, and these are the samples for sign below. So below is the word. So for that, these are the sample frames which are selected by the frame sequence generator. And the second one, figure 3, shows for the same, for sign below. But it is using the concept of image augmentation technique along with the frame sequence generator. And figure 4 also shows one another possible frame sequence for the same sign. So the question can be like, which image augmentation techniques we have used. So these are the set of augmentation types that we have used for our experiments. Those are zooming, rotation, vertical shifting, horizontal shifting, brightness, and shear angle. And these are the parameter range that we have used for our experiment. And this is the model performance, that is the performance of mobile net V2 plus RNN on ISL dynamic gesture data set. So this table shows particularly result for top trainable layers is equal to 6, means we have kept top 6 layers as trainable. Then we have kept top 9 layers as trainable, and likewise we have kept 12 layers as trainable. So this table shows the accuracy as well as the loss for training, testing, and validation. So we can see that the middle row, that is trainable layers, is equal to 9. We are getting the highest accuracy and the highest testing, training, and validation accuracy. And the loss is also minimal. And these are the graphs. So the same table is represented as graph here. So the figure 6 and figure 9 shows the best curves for the accuracy as well and the loss. So for our approach, we were getting 99.57% accuracy, and the authors Nandi et al, they have got 81.94. So clearly we were getting higher accuracy than the existing one. So the conclusion is we have empirically proven that if we use simple concepts like the image augmentation techniques and the pre-trained model with frame sequence generator, it creates a great impact on the accuracy of on ISL recognition. We have proposed an approach that uses mobile net V2 to learn the features from the augmented frame sequence of ISL gestures using a systematic batch of shifted frames to provide the decayed sequences for the same gestures. Currently, we are in the process of working on the data set. So we are creating our own data set of ISL sentences. And in future, we will compare our model performance with other data sets if they will be publicly available. And also the results can be compared by having other pre-trained models to recognize the ISL sign. So later we can just compare the performance of mobile net V2 with other pre-trained models. And these are the references. Okay, so that's it from my side. Any questions?
Participants are requested to post your questions in chat box.
Oh, what is mobile net? Is it ResNet, DarkNet, something like that?
Yes, it is a pre-trained model. Yes, like that only. It is a pre-trained model, but best suited for mobile applications. It is a lightweight model, basically. So the number of layers are very less than ResNet and other models. Basically, it is a pre-trained model. There are two versions, version 1 and version 2. So for our experiment, we have used version 2. It is the latest one, and it is more lighter than version 1. I hope I have answered your question.
Yes, ma'am. One more question. Like if you're getting you might have tried many iterations. If you're getting less accuracy, what did you change? Where did you change to get the higher accuracy?
See, basically, one can try with empirically changing the number of top layers in pre-trained model. If you're talking about the pre-trained model, then we can experiment with more or less number of pre-trained, the trainable layers. So it depends on how much size your data set is having. Right. So for our data set, we were having around 12 to 15 samples, not more than that. So basically, we have tried with trainable layers is equal to 12, then 10, and then 10, and then empirically we have done this, and then we have observed that if we unfreeze just top nine layers, then it was giving us the best accuracy. So we have just considered that for our data set. So it depends on, so if you want to just increase the accuracy, then you can have that parameter to be considered. And you also should see that your model should not get overfitted, because see what happens is when you keep top 20 layers as trainable, then it may happen that your model will get overfitted. In the same way, if you keep very less number as trainable, then you may get underfitting, because it will not learn the feature. The model will not learn the features which are required.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you. So, is there any other question?
If you are having any questions, please unmute and ask, or you can post it in the chat box or question answer section.
Please ask questions for the entire session. All the talks that we had, please ask if there are any questions.
Yes, sir.
So, shall we end the meeting if there are no other questions now?
Yes, sir. As if there are no questions, we can end the session, sir. So,
we'll sign up.
We are at the end of the session, and here I would like to thank Brajesh Bhatt, sir, for a wonderful session on deep learning and examples. The session was very interactive, and hope all of us have enjoyed it. I would also like to thank the Deepang sir and Kinjal ma'am for presenting their nice work. Thank you. Thank you one and all. And there is one announcement for all. Now it's a time for lunch break. So lunch break will be from 1:30 to 2:30 p.m. We will meet for the next session by Dr. Kagalkar sir at 2:30 p.m. Thank you.